Welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Rita Chowdhury from the Department of Ancient Indian History and Culture, University of Calcutta. Our subject is Indian culture. Our paper now is from Polity and it aims to describe the theories regarding the state in early India. Now, so it is important to know that there is no structured work explaining the theories of state in India. Now, in my previous module, I have talked about the important theories regarding the origin of state in early India. They include the theories of social contract, theory of divine origin of state, organic theory of state, and the Saptanga theory of state. In this module, we will be elaborating on each of the theories. Now, in my introduction, we will discuss about how we came about to analyze the theories of state. Now, origin and evolution of the state has been one of the predominant issues in political science. In fact, it has been the key concept in political science since the period of grand thinkers like Plato and Aristotle. In ancient India, thinkers like Bhishma, Narada, Brihaspati, Kautilya, Kamandaka have looked at the problem. On the basis of the writings of these Indian thinkers, we can detect four important theories regarding the origin of the state in ancient India. Now, the four important theories of state are theories of social contract, theory of divine origin, organic theory of state, and the Saptanga theory of state. Out of these four theories, the theories of contractual origin and the divine origin are more prevalent. I mean to say that they have been explained by numerous scholars on the basis of the data that is available to us. So we will now go into the importance of the theory of social contract. The contract theory is the most extensively discussed theory of the origin of the state in ancient India. The reference to contact theory can be seen in the Buddhist texts like Digha Nikaya and the Mahavastu. The theory is also referred to in the Brahminical texts like the Shanti Parvan and the Arthashastra of Kautilya. I want to stress on one important point, that more than the Brahminical texts, the Buddhist text gives a very clear exposition of the theory of social contract. We will see how. The first clear and developed exposition of this theory is found in the Buddhist canonical text Digha Nikaya, where the story of creation reminds us of the ideal state of Rousseau, followed by the state of nature as depicted by Hobbes. The story is stated by the Buddha to refute the Brahmin's claim for precedence over members of all the other social classes. It is said that there was a time when people were perfect and lived in a state of happiness and tranquility. This perfect state lasted for ages, but at last, the pristine purity declined and there set in rottenness. Differences of sex manifested themselves and there appeared distinctions of color. In essence, heavenly life degenerated into earthly life. Now, food, shelter, and drink were required. People gradually entered into a series of agreements amongst themselves and set up the institutions of family and private property. But this gave rise to a new set of problems, for there appeared theft and other forms of unsocial conduct. Therefore, people assembled and agreed to choose as chief a person who was the best favored, the most attractive, and the most capable. In return, they agreed to contribute to him a portion of their paddy. The individual who was thus elected came to hold in serial order three titles: the Mohashammato, one chosen by the whole people, the Kattiya, the lords of the field, and Raja, one who charms the people by means of dharma. This speculation made in the Digha Nikaya is the product of an advanced stage of social development when tribal society had broken up, giving rise to clash of interests between man and woman, between people of different races and colors, and between people of unequal wealth. The idea was adumbrated in the middle Ganga plains and was the basis where paddy was the basis of the economy of the people. Political compact has developed in the Digha Nikaya not only lays a different type of emphasis on qualifications for election as king, but also clearly states the obligations of the two parties. The king has been assigned the task to punish the wicked people. The only definite form of punishment is the banishment of the guilty. Thus, on the whole, the obligation of the head of the state is negative. He steps in only when people break the established laws. The Kattiya, which means the lord of the field, suggests that the primary duty of the king is to protect the plots of one against being encroached upon by the other. Interpretation of the title Raja imposes on the king the positive obligation of charming or pleasing the people. In contrast to the several obligations of the king, the people are assigned only one duty, namely to pay a part of their paddy as contribution to the king. According to the law book of Bodhayan, the king should protect the people in return for 1/6 of the produce. Originally, the agreement takes place between the single Kshatriya on the one hand and people on the other. But at a later stage, it extended to the Kshatriyas as a class. Towards the end of the story of creation in the Digha Nikaya, it is stated that thus took place the origin of the social circles of the nobles, Kshatriya Mandala. The earliest Brahminical exposition of the contract theory of the origin of state in clear terms occurs in the Arthashastra of Kautilya. Just like in the Digha Nikaya, the theory is propounded incidentally in connection with the refutation of the Brahmin's claim of social supremacy. In the Arthashastra, the theory is expounded casually in the course of a talk amongst the spies about the nature of royal power, and into the terms of contract it introduces certain new elements which are absent in the Digha Nikaya. The Arthashastra states that overtaken by a state of anarchy, the people elected Monu Boivashvata as their king and undertook to pay 1/6 of their grain and 1/10 of their article of merchandise in addition to a portion of their gold. In return for these taxes, the king guaranteed social welfare to the people by undertaking to suppress acts of mischief, afflicting the guilty with taxes and coercion. Even the inhabitants of the forest were required to give him 1/6 of the forest produce. this account of the origin of state closes with the moral that the king should not be disregarded. The Cotillian speculation is in keeping with an advanced economy. When different kinds of grain were produced so that the king laid claim not only to an unspecified part of paddy, but also to a fixed part of all kinds of grains produced. Similarly, trade had been established as a regular source of income to the state, for both Mingasinus and Cotillo referred to officers regulating trade in this period. Besides, mining was a thriving industry in the Mauryan age. Finally, the fact that even the inhabitants of the forest are not exempted from taxes is an indication of the comprehensive character of the Cotillian state. Thus taken as a whole, the first three taxes, namely those in grain, commodities and metals, reflect the developed economy of the Mauryan period. All the four taxes mentioned in the terms of contract made between the mythical Monu and the people betray to some extent the elaborate taxation system and the increasingly acquisitive character of the Mauryan state. The contractual origin of the kingship in the Arthashastra is not intended to impose limitations on royal power. On the contrary, the obligation put upon the people are burdensome and are designed to strengthen royal authority. This point is clearly brought out towards the close of the passage, which argues that the king who assures security and welfare to his subjects by eliminating wrongful acts through coercion and taxes should never be disregarded. Hence, Cotillo's contract theory is purported to buttress royal power like that of Hobbes, rather than to limit it like that of Locke. In Western political tradition, three philosophers, Hobbes, Locke and Rousseau, who are jointly known as contractualists, formulated the social contract theory regarding the origin of state. Contractualist philosophers start their description with the depiction of human nature. Based on this human nature, they make a description of the state of nature, which is a stage prior to the creation of the state. They claimed that the state is not a natural institution, but is created by a contract, which suggests that the political authority is the result of mutual consent among individuals. Now, before we go on to the divine origin of the state, I would like to recapitulate some of the theories, the principles that had been given, expounded in the theory that I have already analyzed. Now, we have seen that there was a close correspondence between the theories adumbrated by Hobbes, Locke and Rousseau in Western Europe and in India by our ancient writers. Now, there is so much affinity between the two theories that it is we can assume that they had some kind of idea were being exchanged between the two, though we are not very sure about that, because Hobbes, Locke and Rousseau's theories are not completely congenial with the time of Cotillo, Monu, Arthashastra and all that. Now, the thing is that they both agree that there was a pre-state condition when people were living in harmony and in peace, because you must remember, because there was no property, no family, no selfish interests would divide the people. But as society developed, we find, say from the 6th century BC, when the 16 Mahajanapadas came into existence, That was a time when society, economy, polity developed simultaneously. Because there was property, there were disputes, there was family, there was some selfish interest. So based on this, there were disputes among the people, and we find that in the theory, a desire has been expressed that there must be someone in authority to resolve all the differences of opinion and all the disturbing activities that were going on. So what they did is that, according to both the scholars on both sides of in India and in Europe, that that some leadership was needed, and it came about through social and political contracts. Now we go on to the theory of divine origin. We analyze the importance of the theory. This is the theory of divine origin, is the most popular theory of the origin of the state in ancient India. Kingship was given divine sanction, and the king was considered not to be the representative of God, but himself a god who contained the power of important gods like Indra, Varun, and Agni. According to A.L. Basham, you must be knowing about his famous book, The Wonder That Was India, the doctrine of royal divinity was explicitly proclaimed. The theory appears first in the epics and then in the law books of Manu. In the Mahabharata, is mentioned the very ancient story of the first man, Manu, who combined the characteristics of Adam and Noah in the Hebrew tradition. The story tells that at the beginning of this period of cosmic time, when greed and rot had disturbed human relations, men inflicted untold misery upon one another. As in the Buddhist legend, they agreed to respect each other's life and property, but they had no confidence in their contracts, and so they approached the high god Brahma to help them. Lord Brahma nominated Manu, here thought of not as a man but as a god, to be their first king. Variants of this story occur in other parts of the Mahabharata and elsewhere, some making the first king Virajas, the son of the god Vishnu. Again, the Manusmriti declares in dignified language, I quote, "When the world was without a king and dispersed in fear in all directions, the Lord created a king for protection of all. He made him of eternal particles of Indra and the wind, Jamo, the sun and fire, Varuna, the moon, and the lord of wealth." The royal consecration, the Rajasua, which in its full form comprised a series of sacrifices lasting for over a year, imbibed the king with divine power. In the course of the ceremonies, he was identified with Indra, quote, "because he is a Kshatriya and because he is a sacrificer," unquote, and even with the high god Prajapati himself. He took three steps on a tiger skin and was thus magically identified with the god Vishnu, whose three paces covered earth and heaven. The king was evidently the fellow of the god. The magical power which pervaded the king at his consecration was restored and strengthened in the course of his reign by further rites. Such ceremonial rejuvenations, such as the Vajpayee and the horse sacrifice, the Ashwamedha, not only ministered to his ambition and arrogance, but also ensured the prosperity and fertility of the kingdom. The Brahmanic rituals such as the horse sacrifice fell into destitute under the Mauryas, but was revived by the Shungas and was performed by many later kings, both in North and South India. After the period of the Guptas, these sacrifices became rare. However, the last we have been able to trace took place in the Chola Empire in the 11th century. But the tradition of royal divinity continued, and kings referred to their divine status in the titles and panegyrics, and they were regularly addressed by their courtiers as Deva or God. The Chola kings and some others were even worshipped as gods in their temples. In thought, if not in practice, it was the divine theory of kingship which carried most weight with succeeding generations. The author of the Arthashastra had no illusions about the king's human nature and seems to have had little time for mysticism, but he recognized that legends about the origin of kingship had propaganda value. In the Arthashastra, he states that the king should be told that the king fulfills the functions of God Indra, the king of gods, and Yama, the god of death, upon earth. All who slight him will be punished, not only by the secular arm, but also by heaven. Ashoka and other Mauryan kings took the title beloved of the gods, Devanampiya, and though they seem not to have claimed holy divine status, they were no doubt looked upon as superior divine human beings. Now, regarding the divinity theory, we find that it had a longevity, because kings in ancient India found it suitable to describe themselves as either as representatives of gods or as the son of a god or the god himself, because that helped to legitimize their power and also to be popular with the people, because essentially the society and the state in ancient India was religious in nature. So people believed in the divinity of the king more than other secular expositions that were made during this period. Well, and in recent times, you must be knowing that in Orissa, the king is known as the god's very first servitor, means that he was the first servant of God who was to serve the king. And what he did was he offered the state to Lord Jagannath, and he made it be known that he announced it publicly that he was the ruling as the representative of the gods. So, and any kind of treason against him was treason against Lord Jagannath. So you must be knowing, you must be understanding, this theory of divine right of kings was very useful to the kings in ancient India as well. We find that there are some instances in our present state, in different parts of our regions. Now we go on to the next theory, the organic theory of the state. This is the oldest theory of the origin of the state in India and has been mentioned in the Atharva Veda. According to this theory, the state is the result of evolutionary progress and the interdependence among its various constituent organs. The 10th hymn of the 8th chapter of the Atharva Veda gives a picture of the organic origin of the state. On the basis of Atharva Veda, several stages of this evolution of state can be traced. The hymns of the Atharva Veda state that the earliest phase of human life was a stage of boirajyo, or stateless state. It was a state of complete anarchy. But subsequently, with the emergence of agriculture, stable life became possible. To fulfill the needs of agricultural society, the family emerged and the head of the state became the first wielder of authority. Further, the need of cooperation in the different realms of society led to the emergence of Shabha and Shomiti. Shabha was the organization of elderly people and Shomiti was the general assembly of common people. With the emergence of Shabha and Shomiti, organized political life began, which finally culminated in the emergence of the state. The chief functions of the king also throw light on the purpose for which his office was created. One of the main duties of the king was the protection of private property by punishing the thief, and that of family by punishing the adulterators. So great was the responsibility for protecting property that it was incumbent on the king to restore to a subject the stolen wealth at any cost. The preservation of the Bonno caste system was another great responsibility of the king. Generally, the maintenance of the caste system was considered an indispensable element of dharma. According to Kamundako, if dharma is violated by the members of the state, there is bound to be proloy, or dissolution of the whole social order. The dominant ideal that moved the king in ancient India was the attainment of dharma, artha and kama. If artha is taken in the sense of enjoyment of property, then kama can be taken in the sense of enjoyment of family life, and dharma in the sense of maintenance of the legal system. It would be clear that in the Trivargo ideal also, principles of property, family and caste dominated. Now, before we go on to the Saptanga theory of state, what we were trying to elaborate in the organic theory of the state is that the state indispensably consists of a number of constituent elements, and it is stressed herein that amongst the different elements, interdependence was of great importance. So when we go on to the Saptanga theory of state, we find an enumeration of what the Saptanga, or the seven limbs of the state, consisted of. We go on then to the Saptanga theory of state. Brahmanical law books, Dharma Shastras, have delved into various aspects of a kingdom, which was considered as an ideal polity in these treatises. A state, Rajyo, according to the Dharma Shastra of Manu and the Shanti Parva of Mahabharata, consisted of seven limbs, Saptanga. The Kautilya Arthashastra too have enlisted seven elements or prakritis. The seven elements, the limbs, consisted of the Shami, king or the head of the state, the Amato, mantri, minister, or Sachiv, secretary, Janopado, populated territory, Durgo, fort, or the fortified urban area, possibly the capital, the Kosho, or the treasury, the Bolo, force, or Dondo, rod, denoting the army, Mitro, friend, or ally. According to the scheme, each preceding element is more important than each succeeding element. The Shami is the foremost element, followed by the Amato, and the Mitro, being the of least importance, is placed at the end. The graded importance of these elements is judged not in terms of their moral condition, But in the degree of their affliction under calamitous conditions or distress, that is Vaishuno, the greater the degree of affliction of the element or limb by the calamity, the more is the importance of the prakriti or ango. The calamity affects the shami more seriously than that affecting the amatto. So the shami is above the amatto. Though the shami is unanimously viewed as the most important limb of the body politic, each ongo or limb has a prescribed and specific function which can be rendered best by the specific ongo and not by any other limb. Obviously, this concept upholds that each and every limb, in spite of their graded importance, was indispensable and beneficial to six others. Now, it's a very important to note at this juncture that this seven Saptanga theory of state have been accepted by all the later theories, and we find in a most of our texts on polity that the seven elements have been given a place of great importance, because it has also been emphasized that each of the elements are dependent on one another to gain, to make the state a successful institution. And without any one of these elements, a state cannot survive. Though there is a difference of opinion regarding which is the most important element, it must be noted here that Kosho, or the treasury, was regarded as one of the most important element by most of our theorists, because without the Kosho, or the treasury, it is difficult to maintain all other elements intact. So from all these theories, it must be noted that there were wide speculations among our Indian scholars, ancient Indian scholars, regarding what could have been the origin of such a long institution that endured for so long. So there were theories on social contract, when they said that after living happily for some years, they could not survive that way because family and property had come into existence, and this led to disputes. Now, because of these disputes, people were forced to make contact with one another and set up the institution of kingship or the state. Now, again, there were theories who maintained that it was theory of divine origin that was most important, because we must remember that most of the texts were written on the basis of religious ideas and religious concepts. So they actually wanted to give king a sense of divinity. They surrounded the king with a sense of divinity so that it was more wholly acceptable to the people. Now we have the organic theory of state, which is also very logical, because the state does consist of a number of elements, and we have to also recognize that they are all interdependent, because none of the elements can work independently, independent especially of all the other elements. And lastly, the Saptanga theory of state gives a great amount of emphasis to the existence of all the elements altogether, and to what kind of distress they may be subjected to, and if it so occurs that there is some havoc in the state, which will be affected first. So they have their idea of graded importance of the elements are vary according to each theories, but there is a basis of fact in all of these theories. So we cannot accept one disregarding the others. So I think it is better to analyze the theories and to realize that there is a certain amount of truth in each of the theories that we have mentioned. I hope I have been able to clear the doubts in your mind and to analyze all the questions that you might need answers for. For any more information that you need, please visit EPG Pathshala. Thank you.